So what I want to talk about today is a moment that really changed the Reagan presidency and in many ways kind of set up a lot of what was going to happen in the 1980s. Here in this country, we have kind of a weird relationship with presidents. We like people before they get elected. Obviously we vote for them, we were excited about them. Then we elect them. And we don't like them. We tend especially when they first get in office. And then after they're out of office, we like them again. I mean, it's a really weird thing. And people always forget that a president's first year, and sometimes even their first couple of years, are almost always pretty rough. And I mean, right now I'm recording this just before Halloween of 2022, and there's a lot of anger and resentment towards Biden. We'll see if that goes away or not. It's hard to say, but every president from Trump to Obama to Bush, Clinton, Bush, Reagan, the first year, sometimes even the first 2 years, really don't go well, and then people forget about that later. They get used to them. Sometimes what they end up doing starts to actually work, and but it is an interesting phenomenon. So for Reagan, people do forget that that first year was a lot rougher than people realized. This is a graph showing at the end of their first year the approval rating for various presidents of the modern era. And actually, Reagan has one of the lower ones, even though he today is seen as the guy that everybody liked, and in both elections he wins by a landslide. But actually, he had a pretty rough first year. And in fact, his first couple of months, there was already buyer's remorse for Reagan. He was trying very hard to get through some economic policies. And we'll get into the details of those in a different lecture. But basically, trying to cut taxes, cut some of the government spending on some things, but then raise government spending on things like defense and other areas. Something that will become known as Reaganomics. And he can't get them through. And again, his approval ratings were really tanking in February and early March, which is why this was such a big deal on March 30th, about 2:25 p.m. on a Wednesday. This happened. So what should happen? Obviously, it's Reagan was shot at. Six shots were fired altogether in a little less than 2 seconds. I'll get into the details of what exactly happened as far as the bullets are concerned. But Reagan had just given a speech at the Washington Hilton Hotel, just a little ways down from the White House. A very short speech to the AFL, American Federation of Labor. Reagan was not. By this point, was not a big supporter of unions. In fact, one of his first big acts as president will be, it happened after this, but will be the firing of air traffic controllers, a major union that went on strike, and he fired them all. So he this was a hostile audience. And in fact, he did not get the warmest reception. Very short speech, barely 20 minutes. He's walking out. There's only about 30 feet between the door and the limo he's getting in. So there's about 30 feet where he was vulnerable, and that's when what happened. It was not very clear what exactly happened at that point. Obviously, shots were fired. You can see some people are on the ground. But as is often the case in these kind of events, there's a lot of confusion and a lot of bad info going out. And especially then when they were, I mean, five cameras capture this. The footage I showed you is the most common footage you see, but there were five different cameras because he is president. Whenever presidents go, people are there. But today there would be a lot more with cell phones and personal cameras and digital cameras and such. I talk about this because I teach a course called Critical Thinking, and I focus a lot on urban legends and conspiracy theories. And this is something that people often do is something happens, there's a news report, and then later they get more info and the news report changes and people go, they changed their story. And again, what the reality is, we just don't know what happens sometimes. There is a conspiracy theory about this that I'll tell you. I don't believe it, but it is an interesting conspiracy theory, but I'll talk about that in a moment. So here is one of the very first reports of what happened.
And shots were fired, apparently at President Reagan, as he was coming out of the Washington Hilton Hotel this afternoon. The president was not hit. He was pushed into his limousine and immediately taken away to safety. However, three persons were hit. We believe they are two Secret Service agents and the president's press secretary, James Brady. And we do not.
And other than the president, the rest of it is accurate. Actually, it's one Secret Service agent and one D.C. police officer named Timothy DeHanty. And the Secret Service agent was Tim McCarthy, who was shot. But again, as you can see, the initial news reports, Reagan not shot. That's not true, it turns out. Turns out Reagan was actually shot in the arm and chest, just barely missing his lung and heart, in fact, which news reports very quickly realized. Again, this is ABC News. You can find online NBC, CBS, CNN, which was a brand new network at this point, not even a year old. And this was one of their big days. People started tuning into CNN. This idea of a 24-hour news channel was seen as a ridiculous idea by a Georgian named Ted Turner, who owned a local station in Atlanta. He came up with this idea, and people thought it was a big folly. And of course, now we can't imagine not having 24-hour news. Anyway, but the ABC got the story out first, and they tend to be the one we always focus on. They realized pretty quickly that they had made a mistake, and you can see on the air as they're realizing
this. Typed information I have is that he is okay. Speak up. The president was hit. The president was hit. All this that we've been telling you is incorrect. We now must redraw this entire tragedy in different terms. The president was hit today. He was hit in the left chest, but we are told he is all right. He is at George Washington University Hospital.
Basically, we have this information. The president was shot once in the left chest. The bullet entered from the left side. He is conscious. He is in stable condition. And that literally...
And keep in mind, by the way, that the person who wasn't talking in of the two reporters, that's a guy named Sam Donaldson. He's still around, at least as of 2022. But he was the main reporter for ABC. He was the main White House reporter. And if you ever watch any footage of a Ronald Reagan press conference, you will always hear Sam Donaldson, Mr. President, Mr. President. He was kind of loud and always asked the awkward questions. So anyway, and keep in mind that this is 1981. It's 41 years as I record this since this happened. At that point, it was only 18 years since John F. Kennedy had been shot and killed. And there was a sense by a lot of people that this is history repeating itself, you know. I'll talk about this again more in a moment, but, you know, from Kennedy through Reagan, there were a series of either assassinations or at least assassination attempts. This was actually being kind of the last major one in the U.S. at this point. But at that time, it just seemed like, oh, here we are again. But I'll come back to that in just a moment. So again, this is kind of another angle that you rarely see, where you can see the door and where Reagan was shot. You can also see where the Secret Service, Tim McCarthy, was shot. The D.C. police officer, Tim DeHanty, and James Brady, the press secretary. I'll talk more about Brady in a moment. Anyway, lost my train of thought. Sorry. All right, so it's not funny, but I blanked out for a second there. So who actually did this? This was a person named John Hinckley. At the time, 26 years old, young man, which unfortunately seemed to be, again, a regular pattern. Young, single men with perhaps mental issues, lashing out at society for some reason, in some cases hoping for some kind of glory or fame. Again, this seemed to be a much larger pattern repeating itself. John Hinckley was from Texas. He was from an oil family. In fact, I'll go ahead and tell you the quick untrue but conspiracy theory, because he did actually know and grew up with the Bush family. He knew George W. Bush. He knew Jeb Bush. Of course, George H.W. Bush had ran against Reagan in 1980 for president. It was a bitter election. And in fact, I showed you some footage of Bush and Reagan. Eventually, Reagan did indeed choose Bush to be his vice president. He was supposed to choose Gerald Ford. I don't remember if I've said this already, but he was supposed to choose Gerald Ford. But Gerald Ford wanted to be sort of a co-president. And Reagan was like, no. So he, instead of choosing Gerald Ford, he went with George H.W. Bush. So Bush was the vice president. So you have the current president being shot and, you know, at this point, maybe killed by a friend of the Bush family. So there was a little bit of nervousness there. But again, there's no evidence of obviously of any foul play on the Bush family, but that is the conspiracy theory about this. But he was from an oil family in Texas. He did know the Bushes. He did have major issues with depression. Later, he would be diagnosed as schizophrenic. He had been suicidal. He had been in and out of mental hospitals by the late 70s. This is a photograph from 1979 of him posing with his gun. He was obsessed with guns. He was very into gun culture at this point. He had become obsessed with a movie called Taxi Driver, a Martin Scorsese film from 1975, starring Robert De Niro and Jodie Foster and Harvey Keitel, about a loner, a Vietnam veteran, who is having a hard time readjusting into society. One of the stars of this film, again, is Jodie Foster, who played a young prostitute in the film. She was 12 going on 13, and that's the character she plays. Robert De Niro plays a character named Travis Bickle, the Vietnam veteran, who at some point in the movie decides to save the character of Iris, which is this young prostitute played by Jodie Foster. Let me play you a little bit from the movie. It's a great film. It's one of the classic 70s movies. This is what kind of made Martin Scorsese a major director. This is the movie that really put De Niro on the map. He had been in Godfather Part II, won an Oscar, but this is really the film that people know Robert De Niro from. So if you've only known Robert De Niro from some of the silly comedies he's made in the 2000s, this might be a bit of a revelation. I'm going to play you a couple of scenes from Taxi Driver. So this is the trailer, in case you're not familiar with the film.
So what do you want to hack for, Bickle?
I can't sleep nights.
This porn up there just for that?
Yeah, I know, I tried that.
So what do you do now?
Ride around nights, mostly. Subways, buses. Figure, you know, I'm gonna do that, I might as well get paid for it.
Travis, you run all over town, don't you?
Yeah.
I mean, you handle some pretty rough customers, huh?
Yeah.
You carry a piece?
No.
You need one?
No.
12 hours of work and I still can't sleep. Damn. Days go on and on. And they don't end.
Things got you down?
Yeah, it got me real down. Real. I just want to go out. I really want to. I got some bad ideas in my head. I just.
It If you want to see, by the way, since we've talked a bit about crime in the 70s, if you want to see sort of what New York looked like in the mid 70s, this film actually does give you a good sense of how bad New York was at this point and the crime and such. As part of the film, he, again, he's somebody, as you can kind of see from that clip, he can't quite fit in. He doesn't quite know who he is, and he's angry, he's lashing out. At one point, he decides he's going to shoot a politician who's running for state office in New York to impress a woman played by the actress Sybil Shepherd. But he sort of gets found out by the Secret Service before he has a chance to do anything. And I'm about to show you the most famous scene in the movie. At the very beginning of the scene, you can see he's running away from his attempted assassination attempt. I mean, he doesn't actually do it, but he's thinking about it, and he realizes they're on to him, and he runs away. And that goes into the next scene. And if you've ever heard anybody imitate Robert De Niro, 99% of the time, this is the scene that they're doing if they're going to imitate him.
Damn it.
So again, young man, obsessed with guns, alone, trying to figure out what he's going to do.
Than you. I saw you coming, you fucker. Shit heel. I'm standing here. You make the move. You make the move. It's your move. I'll try it, you. You talking to me? Well, then who the hell else are you talking to? You talking to me? Well, I'm the only one here. Who the fuck do you think you're talking to? Oh, yeah? Huh? Okay.
And that's what everybody always does. You know, if they're doing Robert De Niro, are you talking to me? What's interesting about this scene, first off, it was almost entirely improvised. And the sounds you hear in the background are real sounds at a real apartment complex. And it's such a private moment because I think a lot of, I can only speak for men, but I think a lot of men have done something like this where you're practicing in your head what you would say if somebody came up to you, and you know, and he's literally looking in the mirror, learning how to be tough. But so after he abandons his assassination attempts, he happens to see a young girl who's clearly a prostitute. He sees her with her pimp, played by Harvey Keitel, and he decides that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to rescue her. This is just a real quick scene. Again, this is the actress Jodie Foster with Robert De Niro. I cut it real short because the language gets strong really fast. But I just want to play you a little bit of it.
Why do you want me to go back to my parents? I mean, they hate me. Why do you think I split in the first place? There ain't nothing there.
Yeah, but you can't live like this. It's a hell. A girl should live at home.
Didn't you ever hear of women's lib?
What do you mean, women's lib? You're a young girl. You should be at home now. You should be dressed up. You should be going out with boys. You should be going to school. You know, that kind of stuff.
God, are you square?
Hey, I'm not square. You're the one that's square. You're full of shit, man. What are you talking about? You walk out with those fucking creeps and lowlifes and degenerates out on the street and you say...
Anyway, you can hear it escalate real quick. And what's interesting, I think, again, this movie came out in the mid-70s. But it's already addressing some of the fears that we've talked about in this class about protecting youth and how, you know, young people being exploited for violence and sexual exploitation and things. So, I mean, in fact, a lot of that imagery that people had by the late 70s when we talked about Halloween or we talked about disco, we're coming from movies like this. Anyway, I know I've kind of dove into this a little more maybe than I should, but I wanted you to get a sense. Oops. That went crazy. Okay. this is a sloppy day today. Okay, so but I wanted you to have a sense of the movie itself. Let me. I'll go ahead and spoil the film for you. So he does end up saving her. He shaves his head into a mohawk. And he's kind of, in other words, a sign that he's totally kind of lost it. He goes in, shoots up the pimp and all his other bad guys, and then rescues the girl. It's clearly, you know, insane. But the movie ends where he's a hero because he saved a young girl. And the kind of the moral of the film sort of is like, you know, sometimes our heroes really are villains. It just depends on how we look at them. John Hinckley was obsessed with this movie. He had a 16mm print of it. He watched it over and over and over. To him, he was Travis Bickle. And he had the same feelings that Travis Bickle had in it. And he became obsessed with the actress Jodie Foster. And by this point, Jodie Foster was, by the early 80s, she was, you know, now 18. She was in college at Yale. And he would write her over and over and over. He would call her. We now know that he went to the place. He would watch her sometimes. And it became kind of a joke amongst Jodie Foster and her friends. Like, oh, that crazy guy is calling you again. That John Hinckley guy. Can you believe? Oh, you got another letter from John Hinckley. Oh, my gosh, this guy going to leave me alone. Obviously, he's stalking her. But to be honest, this is before stalking became something that people saw as a problem. You know, in other words, even the term stalking kind of came about after John Hinckley and a few of these other cases that happened in the 80s of young actresses being stalked by crazed fans. I mean, this is literally the case that made people kind of aware of this problem. So, you know, during the trial, this is, you know, one of the many letters that were sent. This is him on March 6, 1981. I love you 6 trillion times. Don't you maybe like me just a little bit? You must admit I'm different. It would make all this worthwhile. John Hinckley. By the way, Jodie Foster has rarely ever talked about this. And you can imagine why. She's already a very, very private person. And she wrote an article for Esquire in 1982 about this. She also did one interview where she talked about it. And then she did testify at the trial. John Hinckley said he wouldn't participate in the trial unless Jodie Foster testified. She did agree to it. There's no footage of it. It was, you know, kind of done under closed doors, but she did testify. And that's pretty much all she's ever talked about this. Real quick, probably be a bad time to say I'm a big fan of Jodie Foster, because I actually am a huge fan. But she did have another stalker, actually, while she was at Yale. Partly inspired by John Hinckley, there was another person that was obsessed with her and, in fact, went to the play she was at in Yale with a loaded gun. But her performance apparently moved him, and he didn't act on his impulses and then later was caught. So anyway, this is one of the letters. This was actually written on the day that Reagan was shot. I mean, this is one of the last things he did before he shot Reagan. So essentially, John Hinckley had this idea that he was going to shoot Reagan, like Travis Bickle was going to do in the movie, to impress Jodie Foster so she would fall in love with him. So he went to D.C. to do this. Let me back up for a moment. He had already thought about doing this a couple of years earlier, but he was going to do it to Jimmy Carter. But in fact, actually got caught at the Nashville airport with a suitcase full of guns and a pair of handcuffs, and actually went to jail for that, and to a mental institution as well. But nobody knew that he had these assassination plans. Once he got out, he goes to Rocky's Pawn Shop in Texas, buys a gun, gets on a plane, goes to D.C. He wants to shoot Reagan, has no idea how he's going to do it. He's in a McDonald's. He sees a newspaper that mentions tomorrow Reagan will give speech at Hilton Hotel. He goes, oh, I will be there. And that's exactly what he did. Showed up the next day. But before he did that, he wrote a letter and mailed it to Jodie Foster. And this is it. In one part of it, it says, over the past 7 months, I've left you dozens of poems, letters, and love messages, and the faint hope that you could develop an interest in me. Although we talked on the phone a couple of times, I never had the nerve to simply approach you, which also means he's been around her. I never had the nerves to simply approach you and introduce myself. The reason I'm going ahead with this attempt now is because I cannot wait any longer to impress you. And he goes on to call it the greatest love gift in the world. But again, if you look at the very opening line, this is, there is a definite possibility that I will be killed in my attempt to get Reagan. So, I mean, you know, he's right up front about what he's going to do. Of course, she doesn't get this till long after the fact. Oops, sorry. Let me get past these clips here.
What do you want me to play?
So again, he does go to trial. I mean, it's obvious he did it. There's witnesses there. He never denies that he did it. He does go to trial. And he is technically found not guilty due to insanity. And even though that the idea of not guilty because of insanity is an old defense, we can see it going back to the ancient Romans. This was part of common law in England and in the United States. This was one of the first major cases in the modern era where this was the verdict, and it really angered a lot of people. And again, put ourselves back in the time, late, you know, this is 82, you know, this is still a time of really high crime in America. There's a lot of debates about this. Think Dirty Harry. There's a lot of anger about this. But it is, again, if you will, a legitimate decision. Again, it is considered unlawful if somebody truly is insane to try them as a sane person. In the same way, we don't execute people with very clear mental problems. And again, the insanity defense becomes kind of a common attempt. It rarely works, by the way. For instance, somebody I did not talk about already, Son of Sam, David Berkowitz, a serial killer in New York City who in 1979 was going around shooting people, 1977, going around shooting people, kind of like the Zodiac Killer. He would later claim that he was hearing voices, maybe the devil himself. He later admitted that that was just an attempt to portray himself as insane, and it didn't work. It rarely ever actually works, by the way. You would see scores of TV shows and movies where characters try to do this, but it is quite rare. Dr. William Carpenter now teaches up at Wolford College in South Carolina, actually was the psychiatrist that was on his case and interviewed him for over 40 hours and diagnosed him as schizophrenic and said, yes, he really, really, really did have mental problems. It was, in other words, it was a legitimate verdict, as aggravated as that might be. We'll come back to that verdict and his diagnosis later. All right, so that's John Hinckley, why he did what he did, and essentially what he did. But there was a lot of fear at this time, because again, they're still not quite sure what's happening to Reagan. Is he dying? Is he near death? He was 70 years old. You know, and even today, that's not young. And back in 1981, you know, that was kind of getting to the top age for a lot of men at that point. I mean, the average lifespan for men was still late 60s, early 70s. Today, we're talking 90s now. But at that time, you know, that was an elderly man. And for anybody to take a bullet, let alone a 70-year-old man, was a big, big deal. One of the problems at this point was the vice president, George H.W. Bush, was not in D.C. He was out making, you know, he was making the rounds, and he was actually in Texas giving a speech. In fact, he was supposed to go on to Austin to give another speech when he gets word on Air Force Two, you know, the vice president plane, that, yes, indeed, Reagan has been shot. And there is a very good chance he might end up being president very shortly. At the very least, he's going to be acting president. And it's interesting, you know, now long after the fact that we have papers of all these people and the records, this is something that he had written down as he was processing the day. He kind of wanted to capture his thoughts. A lot of these presidents, and Reagan and Bush both being good examples of this, kept diaries. I think that's something people do less so today, but they both were big diary keepers. And so they often in big events would make a point of writing down their thoughts for posterity, which is great for us historians. But this is actually him writing down some of his thoughts that day. Enormity of it comes upon me 20 minutes out of Austin to pray literally that Ronald Reagan recovers. Element of friend not just commander in chief or president, decent, warm, kind person, you know, on and on. So, and again, there is a lot of confusion. Now, this is an image with George Bush after he's back in D.C. But the cabinet, you know, they were all beginning to gather, CIA chief and FBI director and the Secretary of State and Secretary of the Treasurer. They're all showing up going, you know, what do we do? I mean, who is president? Bush is not here right now. How do we handle this? And there was real concern. This is the height of the Cold War. The second height, maybe I should say, the height was Cuban Missile Crisis. 20 years later now, we're at the maybe what might be considered the second height of the Cold War. 1981 to about 1986 was a time of real tension between the U.S. and Russia. In fact, the election of Reagan was part of that tension. And in fact, in March of 1981, Poland, kind of like in World War II, Poland was looking like it might be a flashpoint. Technically, Poland, of course, was part of the Soviet sphere of influence, although technically they were an independent nation. And there was something known as the Solidarity Movement, basically a workers' movement that was outright challenging communist rule in Poland. And in fact, Russia was getting ready to perhaps even invade Poland to quell this clear rebellion that, by the way, will eventually succeed in overthrowing communism in Poland. We'll talk about that another day. But there was real concern that Russia might be sparking a war, and what would we do in that moment? So there's already those fears that literally that day we might see action. And who's going to make the decision? Who is commander-in-chief at this moment? There's also a lot of fear because, again, at this moment, nobody knows anything about Hinckley. Is he a Russian agent? Is this Russia trying to maybe create confusion so they can then invade Poland? It seems almost silly today, but at that moment, it wasn't a silly idea. By the way, Russia, led by Leonid Brezhnev, very quickly sent messages out saying, we had nothing to do with this. Again, same thing that happened under Kennedy when Kennedy was shot and killed was the fear by Russia that they would be blamed for this. And Kennedy was even worse because the assassin, Oswald, had actually spent time in Russia. Anyway, so there was a lot of debate over who was in charge. And the Secretary of State, Al Haig, we've mentioned him before. He was a five-star general. He had been National Security Advisor under Nixon. He was the person that told Nixon about the Pentagon Papers. So we've actually heard his voice already. He was already a controversial Secretary of State. Reagan kind of realized he had made a mistake. He will eventually be fired. But this is the moment everybody remembers. So Al Haig was meeting, you know, they were in the White House, and he just kind of casually said that, well, if Bush isn't here, I'm in charge. And everybody else was like, no, that's actually not right. But they didn't correct him. And suddenly they realized Al Haig was not in the room. And then suddenly they saw him on television, and this is what ended up happening. So I'm going to play the clip. It's, you know, actually, this is CNN. In fact, Bernard Shaw, who was the first anchor, the person on the right, he just passed away this year, 2022. Anyway, here are them breaking into the news about Al Haig.
Dan, let me interrupt you, and let's go back to the White House and Secretary Alexander Haig.
Touch with the vice president, who is returning to Washington. We have in the Situation Room all of the officials of the cabinet who should be here and ready. At this time, we have informed our friends abroad of the situation. The president's condition, as we know it, stable, now undergoing surgery. And there are absolutely no alert measures that are necessary at this time or contemplate. Now, if you have some questions, I'd be happy to take them.
Crisis management, that couldn't be effect when it arrived?
Crisis management is in effect.
Who is making the decisions for the government right now? Who's making the decisions?
Constitutionally, gentlemen, you have the president, the vice president, and the secretary of state in that order. And should the president decide he wants to transfer the helm to the vice president, he will do so.
Who makes that decision?
As of now, I am in control here in the White House, pending return of the vice president, and I'm in close touch with him. If something came up, I would check with him, of course.
And now, if you've taken political science or you've taken American government, you know he is completely wrong about that. I'll come back to that in 2 seconds. One thing I did want to point out, you do hear the emotion in the voice. He kind of cracks for a moment. You heard that in some of the anchors as well. It's always interesting going back in these moments and realizing how scary they were at the time. So again, Al Hake just kind of showed up. He makes this announcement. And everybody very quickly is like, what is he talking about? There was even some people who said, is he trying to take over? Which he clearly isn't. He's really just trying to reassure the nation, but actually made it worse. Because again, he clearly was not in charge. I have read reports because the Vice President Bush saw this live on Air Force Two, and he didn't say anything, but apparently his expression said it all. He was furious, although when he showed up, he did not let on. So at the time, based on the Constitution, this would be the presidential line of succession in 1981. So it starts with Reagan, obviously, then the vice president, then the Speaker of the House, which at that time was the Democrat Tip O'Neill, then the Senate pro tempore Strom Thurmond, then Al Haig, and then Secretary of the Treasury Donald Reagan, Secretary of Defense Caspar Weinberg, Attorney General William Smith. And today, as I record this in 2022, obviously it's going to date this if you're watching this a couple of years from now, but this was what it would be right now. Joe Biden, President, Vice President Kamala Harris, Speaker of the House Nancy Pelosi, Senate Pro Tempore Chuck Grassley, then the Secretary of State Antony Blinken, and on and on. In fact, there's at least 17 in that line, just in case there's a massive tragedy. It is one of the most famous and infamous political blunders in American politics. Again, Alexander Haig was a major player in D.C. He'd risen to the highest ranks in the military. Again, was a few heartbeats away from being president. Four heartbeats away from being president. He would actually run for president in 1988 against George H.W. Bush. Disastrous campaign, by the way. And I remember for years and years saying that when he does pass away, this will be the opening line of his obituary. He died not too long ago. And yes, it was the opening line of most of the obituaries. The man who claimed to be in charge at the White House. He would not be Secretary of State much longer. He was brash, as you can kind of tell. He was incredibly ambitious. I mean, again, the fact that he felt this need to run down to say this. And there's no doubt this played a role in it. Although Reagan made a big deal about not immediately firing him after this. I love this photo. It's probably just a coincidence, but he looks very sheepish there. George Bush did apparently say, hi, Al, how are you doing? When they first met, when he arrived at the White House, to kind of show, like, I'm not going to make a big deal about this. But Bush did very quickly take charge, and except for those couple hours of uncertainty, there was no major issues with this. Although they do change the laws a little bit to make this a little smoother of a process. Now, as far as Reagan himself, because I kind of haven't talked much about what actually happened to Reagan. So Reagan was getting into the limousine, you know, they walking out, the shots go off. Jerry Parr, the Secret Service agent that was with him, shoved him into the limo, quickly closed the door. The limo, of course, it's not really a limousine in the way we know it. It's really a tank. It's a beast. It just looks like a car. So once you're inside, you're pretty invulnerable, and that's going to be a problem. So they get into the car. They're going to the White House. There's no sign of blood. In fact, Secret Service agent Jerry Parr says, get to the White House as quick as you can. Reagan keeps saying, you know, you might have hurt my ribs when you pushed me in the car. Secret Service agent was a little nervous. He put his hand into the jacket, felt something wet, and then noticed Reagan was spitting up some blood. The thought was either a bullet or the ribs must have punctured a lung, and he's spitting up blood. Either way, we got to get to the hospital. So tells the Secret Service agent, don't go to White House, go to George Washington Hospital. Again, this is pre-cell phones. They do have car phones. They do have walkie-talkies. But it is interesting how the lack of communication that we wouldn't have a problem with today. So the White House didn't even know this was happening yet. They do manage to call the emergency room and essentially through a code tell them, yes, the president's on his way. And by the way, the Secret Service code for the president at this point was Rawhide, a reference to Reagan's Western film career. So there was the message going out to Secret Service, Rawhide is down, meaning he has actually been shot. He would not have been shot, actually, if the car was not bulletproof. So he did not take a direct hit. Let me, just so I get this right. So there were six shots. So the first shot hit the press secretary, James Brady, through the brain. And we'll talk more about him in a moment. He's alive, but he did take a bullet straight through his head. The second shot hit D.C. police officer Thomas Delahanty in the back. He later had to retire from these wounds. The third shot hit a window across the street. The fourth shot hit Secret Service agent Tim McCarthy, who was actually trying to block Reagan. There was another missed shot. And finally, the sixth hit the limo, bounced off the bulletproof window, and then went through Reagan's underarm into his chest. In other words, he did not take a direct hit. He took a ricochet hit, and that's really what saved him. Had it been a direct hit, he would have died more likely. But again, if it wasn't bulletproof, the bullet would have just gone through the window and he wouldn't have gotten hit at all. He gets to the hospital. He's already lost a lot of blood. He will lose over half his blood before this is over with. But even Reagan doesn't really think he's been shot. He still thinks it's a broken rib. They get to the hospital. He gets out. He decides to walk. But then he collapses, and they have to carry him into the emergency room. One thing that's kind of part of this whole story is Reagan's humor. And love or hate Reagan, he did have a great sense of humor. And it is hard kind of not to like the person, even if you may disagree with his politics. However, I will say the White House also made sure after the fact that everybody knew that he walked out of the limo. I mean, in other words, all these details would be made public because this is going to help Reagan's image. He's not a frail old man. He's a tough guy with a great sense of humor. They had to cut his suit up, which apparently he was saying something about that's a $1,000 suit. But anyway, they cut his suit up. The doctor was getting ready to operate. They're talking over about to put you out. And Reagan apparently, and is, you know, very feeble, but he did make a joke. Hey, is the doctor, I hope the doctor is a Democrat. Oh, excuse me, good Lord, I just ruined it. Reagan says, I hope the doctor is a Republican, which the doctor was actually a Democrat. But apparently the doctor, a guy named Dr. Price, did say, well, today, Mr. President, we're all Republicans. It is ironic, by the way, Reagan sometimes is criticized because he was not a big fan of the women's movement, but actually several of the doctors and nurses that worked on were women at this point. But anyway, they do successfully get the bullet out. They actually had to move both his heart and lung to get it out. What they didn't know, that Hinckley had made these bullets explosive bullets, and they were supposed to explode inside the body. Fortunately, Hinckley didn't quite know what he was doing, so the bullet did not go off, but it could have gone off at any moment as the doctor was removing them, which, again, they didn't know that at the time. Reagan was much, much closer to death than was released at the time. Even a year later, there was a great documentary you can find on YouTube that they did for the show 2020 called Saving the President. And even in there, they don't tell all the details that we now know, again, just how close Reagan was to dying. Apparently, when Nancy Reagan showed up at the White House, showed up at the emergency room, and Reagan was coming out of it, he did look at her and said, honey, I forgot to duck, which is a line from an old boxing movie. And by the way, I mentioned in another lecture that Nancy Reagan was really into astrology, and she would, you know, when they planned events, they always had to go through Nancy Reagan. This is actually when Nancy Reagan decided to start using the astrology to plan his events, so this wouldn't happen again. This, you know, Reagan would always suffer for a long time from this. I mean, until he died, he still had effects of this shot, which makes sense, but most of that wasn't made public at the time. He was in extreme pain for months. This is him arriving back at the White House in April of 1981, And, you know, he's showing the strength, but he's in severe pain, of course, not surprisingly. So it would be 26 days till his first cabinet meeting. This is actually him arriving. And again, you can see Al Hay going, please don't yell at me. You're in charge now. 49 days before he would leave Washington, D.C. again, it would be almost 80 days till his first press conference. And it really wouldn't be till at least October that doctors could say it with any certainty that he is truly recovering. But again, he would show signs of this throughout his life after this. He did miss, he was really into the space program. The first space shuttle is launched during this period, and Reagan sadly had to miss it. We'll talk more about the space shuttle program later in another lecture. So one of the reasons why this matters in the bigger picture is one of the things that it sparked, and that was a debate over guns. This is kind of one of the big political debates, I think, in U.S. politics. And it had already been going on before this, but this is really kind of the debates that we have today. We can really trace most of these debates to Reagan's assassination attempt, even though, again, we're going to talk about this. There were earlier ones, but this is really, it's kind of one long line from John Hinckley to us today over the gun debates. So again, how do you know our right to own arms, which, again, I think a lot of Americans don't realize, like, how strange that is to other countries. You know, as you guys know, I do a lot in Britain. I do a Scotland program there. I have good friends there. One of the things that I will ask often my friends over there, and I always have students ask, I think even in this class, I have a student that's done this. And that would be, I always ask my friends, like, what do you think strange about Americans? I think on the student survey, I make it a little bit different. I say, what would you change about America if you could? And the number one answer is guns. I have a good friend named Penny who lives in Scotland, and I was talking to her not too long ago, and I asked that question, and she just kept saying, I don't get the gun thing. Why do y'all need guns so much? I mean, it really is something that I think we don't think much about. And of course, it's the Second Amendment, the second article, that gives us this right, a well-regulated militia, comma, being necessary to the security of a free state, comma, the right of the people to keep and bear arms, comma, shall not be infringed. There is an earlier draft of it, a well-regulated militia completed of the body of the people being the best security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed, but no one religiously scrupulous of bearing arms shall be compelled to render service. In other words, so again, this earlier draft really links the militia and bearing arms much stronger. The final versions, again, a little more sparse, if you will. And the problem with this is that you can read this two ways. You know, is this saying two things in the same sentence, or is this just saying one thing? So in other words, is it saying, because it is a strangely worded sentence, is it saying we need a well-regulated militia? Again, remember, the United States did not have a national army at this point. The army we used in the American Revolution was disbanded. It wouldn't be till I think 1796 that we actually have an actual national military. There was a real fear of having a military, so the thought was we don't need those. So instead we could have a volunteer militia. So again, is it saying because we need a well-regulated militia, therefore people need to have arms because, again, we don't have a professional army, so we are the army. Or is it saying we need a militia and we should have the right to bear arms? I mean, those are two different interpretations. And really up until the mid to late 20th century, it's really the first interpretation that we have the right to bear arms because we need a militia, like one idea. That's how the Supreme Court and other courts interpreted this. Now, keep in mind, up until the mid-20th century, nobody was debating guns. You know, almost everybody had guns, especially if you lived in the countryside. You needed it for hunting, for protecting your family against animal attacks or against Native American attacks or, you know, in the early days, maybe French or Spanish attacks, right? The thought was, you know, owning a gun is kind of normal, but nobody really thought much about it constitutionally. It just wasn't a thing. That would change as weaponry changes, as technology changes. Also, as the makeup of the United States changes. There is a racial component to this. As African Americans were freed, there were some white Americans that were not comfortable with African Americans owning guns. As we get more immigrants coming over, same thing. But again, in the early days, this just wasn't a debate one way or the other. But again, the courts, whenever they did rule on it, that they did see the Second Amendment as being directly related to the militia. And again, it is interesting when you go through gun laws. I mean, you know, we do actually see restriction of guns right from the beginning. The very first gun law is in the colony of Virginia, 1639, and it actually specifically prevents a certain group of people, in this case, African Americans, from owning guns. So you can already see that racial component right from the beginning. And again, throughout the colonial period, you do see various types of gun laws. In Boston, it's illegal to keep a loaded gun in a home. In Pennsylvania, you're not allowed to have shoot a gun in the city. No dangerous people are allowed to own guns. By the Revolution, nobody who is loyal to Britain is allowed to own a gun. Maryland, no Catholics, which is ironic because Maryland is supposed to be a Catholic colony. Rhode Island, you had to have a gun registry. And pretty much all of them kept people of color from owning guns. After we were the United States, there actually was an attempt by Congress to create a national gun registry, which basically just was simply ignored. So it never went anywhere, but officially we did actually supposed to have a gun register. As I said, the militia was supposed to be our national defense by the 1790s. That was seen as impractical, and the U.S. Army, the U.S. Navy, the U.S. Marines were indeed created at that point. And I've said this over the years. There's often a student will go, well, what about the Air Force? We have to have planes first before we can have an Air Force. But anyway, so again, the whole idea of the U.S. Army will replace the militia system. In fact, by the War of 1812, the militias are gone. We don't have militias anymore, which again is what some of the courts are going to basically say, well, you know, now the Second Amendment is kind of defunct. It's just a vestige of an earlier time that we don't really need anymore. And in fact, the National Guard, the whole idea of the National Guard is kind of the new version of a state militia. Of course, despite its name, it's actually, you know, controlled at the state level, Georgia National Guard, the Florida National Guard. And then if needed be to the federal government can then federalize it or nationalize it for national defense. So again, a lot of people were arguing, well, we're kind of done with the Second Amendment. We do begin to see some gun laws, some gun controls in different waves. We do see an early one in the late 19th century, early 20th century. As we're seeing more and more cities develop, again, people are like, well, we're not hunting anymore. It's too dangerous to have guns. So that was a big fear. Again, people using in those cities using guns to commit crimes. Now there were police forces, which was kind of a new idea, the idea of a professional police force, New York City being one of the first ones to have a true police force. The thought was, well, they can handle the crime. We don't need to do it ourselves anymore. And again, with the rise of segregation, but also the arrival of new immigrants, there again, there was a lot of uncomfortableness by some Americans to allow these new peoples to have guns. And there have been some assassinations, such as James Garfield, the person you see here. Obviously, Abraham Lincoln was killed with a gun. William McKinley, 1901, would be killed with a gun. In fact, he was at a World's Fair when this immigrant and an anarchist shot and killed him. As some of you may know, Garfield would have survived the assassination attempt. And by the way, he was with the son of Abraham Lincoln when he was killed in D.C. So there were Lincolns at two separate assassination attempts. And his problem was they could not find the bullet. Of course, at that time, they were not washing their hands yet. The germ theory was just coming out. So he partly died of infection. Now, he died over several weeks. It wasn't immediate. The Alexander Graham Bell, who was inventing the metal detector, hurried up with the prototype and showed up at the hospital to try to use it. And it kept going off. And they were digging around for the bullet. And then they realized the metal bed frame was actually setting it off. And I've made this joke, but it's actually not a joke. I always joke that Alexander Graham Bell killed Garfield, but it's not completely wrong. Again, today they he would have been fine. You know, he would have been more like the Reagan situation. William McKinley, same thing. He was shot twice. They managed to get one bullet out. They couldn't find the other bullet. They took him to a hospital. Edison was at this World's Fair with a prototype of the X-ray machine, but it was still in prototype form. It was very dangerous, and the hospital did not have electricity, so it wasn't used, and they both obviously died. And again, today they both would have lived the bullet wounds. Reagan is the first sitting president to have a bullet enter his body and survive it. But Teddy Roosevelt, after he was president, was running again in 1912 to be president. He was going to give a speech. It's kind of the inverse of Reagan. He was going to give a speech at a hotel. As he's going in, he is shot by John Schrank. But the bullet went through an eyeglass case that was in his pocket and then through the actual speech that was rolled up in his pocket. This is actually the speech with the bullet hole. This is an X-ray of the bullet in him. And they actually ended up just leaving the bullet in him. He actually died years later with that bullet still in his body. But he does actually survive it. And then, of course, Franklin Roosevelt was shot at before he became president. But it was the mayor of Chicago who was killed, not Roosevelt. So again, these between Lincoln and Garfield and McKinley, it began to make people nervous about guns. So there were some restrictions of gun ownership in some of the cities. In the 20s and 30s, we do see a rise in crime, in particular organized crime, often related to prohibition. But you're also seeing new types of weaponry, things like machine guns and Tommy guns. So the second wave in the 30s, and this is where Congress gets involved, instead of local laws, we're actually seeing national laws. That begin to outlaw the use of machine guns. So again, the 1934 National Firearms Act regulated sawed-off shotguns, automatic guns, silencers, grenades, poison gas. It was a very popular law. The National Rifle Association completely supported it. And even the Supreme Court ruled that, yes, this was a constitutional law. Then you get into the more modern era. We have another presidential assassination with John Kennedy, obviously both Bobby Kennedy running for president, Martin Luther King, also Malcolm X, Medgar Evers. We do see, you know, again, kind of a rash of assassinations happening. And we're also seeing crime starting to go up. There's also some concerns about the civil rights movement and some of the violence connected with that. So we do begin to see another gun control passed by Congress. This one was partly to ban these really cheap guns coming over from other countries. Gun dealers had to be licensed through the federal system so we could track the guns. Some of that's coming from Oswald and Kennedy. But also, you know, not everybody can own a gun, and there are some categories of people who now are not allowed to own guns. And then you get into familiar territory for us, you know, the era of serial killers, the era of even worse crime. George Wallace, running for president in 72, is shot and permanently paralyzed. We know that Ford was shot at twice, in his case, by two women. We've already talked about this, so this is under repetition for you guys. And so, again, there's more and more concern about gun crime. And one of the big concerns is actually a type of gun known as a Saturday Night Special. I didn't play this. I don't have the song here. I was going to play the song by Lynyrd Skynyrd. Maybe I'll link it. But anyway, Lynyrd Skynyrd, the band from my hometown of Jacksonville, Florida, actually have a song about Saturday Night Specials. And, you know, the lyrics, the part of it goes, "Mr. Saturday Night Special, you got a barrel that's black and blue, black and cold, so ain't good for nothing but put a man 6 feet in a hole. Handguns are made for killing, ain't no good for nothing else. And if you like to drink your whiskey, you might even shoot yourself. So why don't we dump them, people," meaning dump the guns. So again, even, you know, Lynyrd Skynyrd, not the most liberal band, and, you know, were gun owners themselves. Even they were like, hey, some of these cheapo little guns that you could buy for $5, $15, you know, on a Saturday night, go out, commit crime. You know, maybe there should be some regulation on these types of guns. And so this becomes a big part of the gun debate by the mid to late 70s, what to do about these really cheaply available guns that you could just walk into a pawn shop, buy it, and walk out. And so Gerald Ford, in his 1976 State of the Union address, specifically asked Congress to pass a law to outlaw these Saturday night specials. And, you know, part of the speech, another major threat to Americans' person and property is the criminal carrying a handgun. The way to cut down on the criminal use of guns is not to take the guns away from law-abiding citizens, but to impose mandatory sentences for crimes in which a gun is used and to make it harder to obtain these cheap guns. So his proposals, as he outlined in the speech, was let's, you know, be tougher on those who commit gun crime, but also let's really try to stop these Saturday night specials from getting easily obtained. Congress didn't actually act on this, so but it did kind of keep the gun debate going. This is actually the gun that Hinckley used to shoot Reagan, and it was considered one of those Saturday night specials. So with Reagan's assassination attempt, this really kind of raised the level of the gun debate to a point that it has stayed there ever since. But it wasn't just Reagan. There was actually somebody else that was shot and killed just 3 months earlier, and that was John Lennon, obviously formerly of the Beatles, still a major star at this point. John Lennon had sort of disappeared for a few years. He was married to Yoko Ono. They had a child named Sean Lennon. He kind of just was a house husband for a while. But in 1980, he actually had kind of come back. He had a new album. And in fact, in December of 1980, he was going around promoting it. This is just a little bit of the music from 1980.
People say I'm crazy, doing what I'm doing.
And again, I think I know a lot of you know the Beatles were a massive band. I mean, I don't think we'll ever see anything like them again. But it is, I think, hard for us to really understand just how big the Beatles were, and in particular, Paul McCartney and John Lennon. And again, he was coming back. He had a new album. He was making the rounds. By this point, he was living in New York City. And suddenly, on December 8th, actually on Monday Night Football, this announcement was made.
It's on the line, and I don't care what's on the line, Howard. You have got to say what we know in the booth.
Yes, we have to say it. Remember, this is just a football game, no matter who wins or loses. An unspeakable tragedy confirmed to us by ABC News in New York City. John Lennon, outside of his apartment building on the west side of New York City, the most famous, perhaps, of all of the Beatles, shot twice in the back, rushed to Roosevelt Hospital, dead on arrival.
And that's, by the way, the voice you heard, that, you know, the main voice is Howard Cosell, very, very famous sports broadcaster in the 70s and 80s. In fact, everybody used to imitate Howard Cosell, you know, so Howard Cosell actually knew John Lennon a little bit. In fact, John Lennon, a few years earlier, had actually appeared on Monday Night Football with Howard Cosell.
Now I've got a most familiar figure and face for all of you across the country here with me now of the original Beatles. Mr. John Lennon.
Hello,
John.
Howard.
Nice to see you, John.
Nice
want
to
move
you.
That up just a little closer.
How are you?
What's been your view of this American professional football scene?
It's an amazing event and sight. It makes rock concerts look like tea parties. But I must say, the first thing I heard when I got in was I'm playing a Beatles tune yesterday, which cheered me up no end. I've been trying to follow the game, but I've...
And now again, it's interesting. I think, you know, with Reagan's assassination attempt, a lot of people actually kind of forgot about it by the end of his term, you know, when he left office in 89. People are like, oh yeah, he was shot because he survived it and stuff. But Lennon, I think, is the one that, at least for, you know, especially for baby boomers, this was really the more shocking event, much more than the Reagan assassination attempt. So the 1-2 punch of John Lennon being killed and then just a few months later Reagan almost being killed really did kind of raise the level of gun control debates to a very high level. Again, I don't think it's ever really died back down. By the way, for anybody who's interested, some of you may know this already. This is one of the last photos of John Lennon. So John Lennon was living in New York in a building called the Dakota. He left to he was doing some more recording. He was leaving. The guy you see on the right, a guy named Mark David Chapman, was a big fan of Lennon, got him to sign an album. Lennon went off. Then Lennon came back. He got out of the taxi with his wife. He was going back into Dakota. And that same guy pulled out a gun and shot and killed John Lennon. So he was killed by a crazed fan. John Hinckley, and again, you look at the history of Mark David Chapman, very similar kind of life to John Hinckley, somebody who had mental problems, was angry at society, a loner, lashing out. I mean, again, you're seeing that pattern. And in fact, John Hinckley was very affected by this two ways. One, he loved John Lennon, so he was very upset. He almost said, there's nothing worth living now that John Lennon is gone. But then he also was kind of influenced by Mark David Chapman and the attention that he got. So in a weird way, the killing of Lennon kind of led Hinckley to speed up his attempt to kill a president. And by the 1980s, again, this is such a familiar pattern. There's a lot of books and studies trying to figure out who are these assassins. Although, again, this is kind of the end of that era, it turns out. And really that personality kind of moved into the mass shooting, something that becomes a huge thing by the 90s and sadly is still with us today. Speaking of music, I'll just play a quick little bit of this. Peter Gabriel, who was a pretty popular singer by the early 80s, was very affected by the death of Lennon and other assassinations, and actually wrote a song. Again, that idea of trying to understand this personality type, which Taxi Driver was dealing with this. This is another, in the music world, another attempt to try to understand assassins.
The streets are lined with camera crews. Everywhere he goes is news. Today is different. Today is not the same. Today I'll make the action. Take snapshot into the light.
And again, it's a song singing from the perspective of an assassin, although it's more about Kennedy, but it was inspired very much by both Mark David Chapman and John Hinckley. So again, there was this heightened awareness of these personality types. So James Brady, again, was the press secretary for Reagan. He had actually worked for Phyllis Schlafly before he worked for Reagan. He would remain the press secretary until 1989. I mean, you can't imagine firing somebody who literally took a bullet. But obviously, he was more akin to a stroke victim where his memory wasn't all there. If you heard him speak, he obviously had, you know, problems formulating sentences. But he was still, I mean, he lived until not that long ago. Not surprisingly, he and his wife became very active in the gun control movement. That's actually him on the ground. Like I said, he did have a bullet go straight through his brain. It is actually a miracle that he survived. So even though he stays on the payroll, he obviously no longer was a functioning press secretary. But again, very much pushed for gun control that was finally passed, I believe in 1993, what's known as the Brady Bill, which essentially did a couple of things. One is, when you buy a gun, you have to have a background check. And two, there is a waiting period, what's sometimes known as a cooling off period. So that if you, you know, if you do have what's sometimes known as temporary insanity, or you're just furious or angry or despondent, you know, there's at least a small period where maybe you have a time to cool off. I won't get into, you know, I'm not a gun owner, but I'm not going to say whether people should own guns or not. But the one argument I would make for not owning a gun is that emotional aspect. Guns don't make you kill people, but sometimes if you do have easy access to a gun and you're immediately angry, in seconds you can do something that you will regret for the rest of your life. And so, you know, there is a real connection between easy access to a weapon and extreme emotions. And so again, that waiting period is at least some attempt to separate those two things, easy access to a weapon and anger. Anyway, so that we do see actual legislation eventually come out of the assassination attempt. And again, it's interesting because I think when you think of Democrats or Republicans, there's kind of automatic ideas of what they're supposed to believe. This is a clip from 1989, just about a month after Reagan had left office, and he's being asked about gun control. And you might be surprised at his answer.
Would be very happy to answer that question. California has a system, unlike that of many other states, in which when you're going to buy a gun, you put down your money and you buy the gun, but you don't get to pick up the gun for several days because investigation is then made to make sure that you're not a felon, that you don't have a record of bad conduct or that you are mental illness or anything. And then you can come back and get your gun. And I do not believe in taking away the right of the citizen to own guns for sporting, for hunting and so forth, or for home defense. But I do believe that an AK-47, a machine gun, is not a sporting weapon or needed for defense of a home.
And again, you can hear there's a lot more nuance at this point. Of course, Reagan was somebody who was shot by a gun, so it is interesting. I think the divide today is much stronger. One side no guns, the other side any guns. And again, in the 80s and 90s, there was a lot more nuanced discussion about guns at that point. I was going to play. This is actually I won't play it just because of time. But this was actually the Lenin's assassination. I forgot to play. So again, the Reagan, this is an image of Reagan recuperating. But again, that's really kind of the big deal, is the role that this assassination attempt played in the gun debate. It also played a massive role in Reagan's popularity. I mean, I don't know if today, as divided as we are, if this would necessarily unite people. I'd like to think it would. COVID did not. But usually when there's a big tragedy, people do unite. And people did unite to some degree behind Reagan. And again, the news reports, were how tough he was and his humor, which is true. But at the same time, it definitely, the White House made sure people knew about it. And as we'll talk about later, a lot of his economic policies that get passed in 1981 would not have got passed had he not been shot and survived it. So again, there's also real world political, frankly, advantages to this, even though it's an advantage that he'd probably rather not have had to go through, but it did actually provide real world advantages. And again, the gun debate does crank up because of this event. And then things like Bernie Goetz's vigilante violence, which we talked about earlier, is also part of this. And again, even though it's very nuanced in the 80s, the divide gets wider and wider and wider over time. And again, people are living very different lives than they once lived. But not only that, but as we see more urbanization on one hand, we also see people who don't live in urban areas living, hunting culture versus sort of city culture, if you will. And then also debates over, well, what is the best solving a crime? Is it a good guy with a gun? Or is it, let's regulate guns and have less guns in anybody's hands? And again, based on what Ford was saying, based on what Reagan was saying, people are saying very different things today. And then, of course, by the 90s, when you start getting things like Columbine, mass shootings, and George Zimmerman's trial over Trayvon Martin back in 2012, we do have very different kind of debates today. And even groups like the NRA has really changed from one of pro-regulation in a lot of cases to almost no regulation today. And again, even as you guys are listening to this, I bet you're having very strong reactions one way or the other. And your reactions are probably a lot stronger than they would have been 30, 40 years ago. And as I said earlier, this is the one thing that a lot of people in other parts of the world, not everybody, but a lot of people think we're very strange about, is how many guns we have. But anyway, so I think from a political science viewpoint, it's a very interesting thing to be studying. So some of you in political science, I think this would make a great capstone project. One last thing, as I mentioned, Hinckley was diagnosed as schizophrenic. He was seen as, the insanity plea was seen as a legitimate plea. In fact, a lot of people, including the person I mentioned earlier, Dr. Carpenter, said that they thought he would only be in prison for a short while he was cured and went through therapy. In fact, they said he actually served more time in prison because of this than he probably would have had he just been simply found guilty. Because, again, nobody was killed. It was attempted homicide. But he was released in 2021. So he is out now. In fact, he actually makes music today. And that's highly controversial. Ron Reagan Jr. Supports this, and he says his father did forgive Hinckley and did recognize that Hinckley was mentally ill. But Patty Davis, the daughter of Ronald Reagan, actually is furious that he's out, and so is the actress Jodie Foster, by the way. And so it is interesting that even, you know, we still debate, and I don't know how I personally feel about this, to be completely honest with you. But anyway, so the debate over crime and guns and how and punishment continues to this day. Okay, that's it. So that is the implications of Ronald Reagan's assassination attempt. Next time we talk, we'll talk a bit more about Reagan and what he actually did as president. Okay, thank you, guys.